Hi, welcome to Peaceworks. I'm Heather Gallion. In this episode, we're going to hear from Greg Boyd, and we asked some people the following question. What do you think of the statement, if only a fraction of Christians actually follow Jesus, the world would be converted overnight?
As Christians, we may, we'll go to church and then, totally say we're committed and everything, and as soon as we hang out with our friends, we're like, we totally drop that. So if Christians kept their morals and what they believed in outside of church, I believe that could be true, that the world could be a lot more peaceful if we stayed to what we believed and not changed because of our friends.
I believe it means that one teardrop could spread into a lake, one river could spread into an ocean.
I think that's totally true. I was watching this interview of a singer from one of my favorite bands, and he said, only love can save. And I think that's totally true. If you're a Christian and you want to tell people about Jesus and stuff, don't worry about shoving the Bible in their face and telling them all the laws and all the rules they have to follow. Just teach them that they have to love, because in the end, only love can save. So yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Because if even just a small fraction of people converted to just focusing on Jesus, then that can spread quickly throughout the world and through other Christians and through other people.
Let's see what some others had to say about that.
The Apostle Paul says that the state bears the sword, mm-hmm. and should have the sword. And since Well, now we partnered all together. Now, what a wicked weave we web. What a, you know what I'm saying.
Oh, what would a wicked weave we web.
Yeah, sure. The Apostle Paul says, you know, since the stake can bear the sword, and since we're kind of like a Christian nation and everything, and we've got Possible? Christians. Yeah. Well, doesn't that mean?
Don't recall that verse.
Well, you know, it's our responsibility to vote and take office and elect a Christian to be in charge. So if that's the case, doesn't it mean that Christians can bear the sword because we have Christian states and the state bears the sword?
Right. Paul does say that. In Romans 13, God has ordained the governments to carry the sword. Mm-hmm. Now, the word ordained there, tasso, it has the connotation of to file. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that he controls them. Thank goodness, because otherwise it would mean that God set Hitler in order just to do exactly what he did, and mm-hmm. Stalin and every other crazy world leader there's ever been, mm-hmm. as though they were carrying out God's will. But mm-hmm. it means that God takes the governments, just as they are, and now he's going to use them, orchestrate them, to carry out as much justice as possible. Since they're going to use the sword, he says, okay, I will use that. In the same way that throughout the Old Testament you find him doing this. It's like, here's Assyria, they're a nasty nation, sword-wielding nation. Here's his people, Israel, they're rejecting him. So sometimes God says, okay, if you're going to reject me, then I'm gone, but with me comes the protection. So now Assyria, you can do what you want to do with them. Mm. You find this in Isaiah 10. And he refers to Assyria as the rod of his wrath. But all he's doing is saying, okay, since you love violence and you're pushing me away and don't want me, well then I'll use them to punish you.
Right.
But it's not that he approves of Assyria, because actually he turns around and then punishes Assyria for being the kind of nation that would do what they just did to Israel. Okay, so God finds the governments of this world, they're all violent, they're all sword-yielding. He says, oh, that's the way it is. I will be at work in that, because I'm not a prissy God who just wants to stay up there in heaven. I'll get involved and I'll run the world through that. But that does not mean that Christians are supposed to be part of that sword wielding. And to see that, all you need to do is read the chapter before. And remember that in the original, there was no chapter divisions.
Right.
So he set it all up. In Romans 12, Paul says, starting with verse 17, here's your duty, Christians, is to do good, to never be overcome with evil, but to overcome evil with good. When your enemy's thirsty, give him something to drink. When your enemy's hungry, give him something to eat. Never exact vengeance, he says, but leave all vengeance to God. Then he says, here's how God exacts vengeance. He uses the governments who carry the sword to exact vengeance on wrongdoers. He uses the same word that he just told us never to do. And so Paul's saying, leave it to God to take care of the world and you know, the violence stuff. Don't you ever participate in this. And here's one of the ways that God does it. He uses governments, which of course are always going to be wielding the sword, and he'll be in charge of that. Our job then is to submit to the government as much as possible.
Yeah.
It's not worth fighting over, but it doesn't mean that we're supposed to ever pick up the sword. In fact, that I think is forbidden.
It seems pretty clear to me. When I hear you talk it through, it reemphasizes just how clear it is. Why do you think it isn't for so many Christians who have been living with the same Romans 12 and 13 partnered together? Don't seek vengeance, pour coals, hot coals of love, you know, on your enemy's head. I mean, just don't be a part of vengeance. Well, then leave vengeance for God. How will God do that? Well, the state will have the sword. Answers that question.
Right.
So clear. And yet, wonderful scholars that I'm sure we both respect have been living with the same two chapters for so many years and don't seem to see it. Does this come full circle to what we were talking about earlier?
It does. This teaching is the most radical and I think the most beautiful, the most counterintuitive aspect of the kingdom, of the whole gospel message. You have to die to yourself to live like this. To the extent that you are conditioned by the pattern of the world, conditioned by your ordinary common sense, naturalistic reasoning, to that degree, this teaching won't make any sense, and you'll have to find a way of getting around it. Now, Jesus knew this. He knew that what he was saying was crazy. He says, you've heard it said, love your friends but hate your enemies, of course, but I'm calling you to do this radically different thing. Imitate me. That's another theme you find throughout the whole New Testament. Peter even applies it specifically when Christians are being persecuted. He says, when you're brought before the authorities, remember the example of Jesus. And so we're called to follow that, to imitate him. But that that simply goes against everything that this world tells us is normal.
Yeah.
And even is right and just.
Yeah. And so we're preconditioned and have absolutely a hard time shaking some of that when we look at the text.
I it's very hard for us to let its full radical beauty impact us. Mm. And because it could cost us something.
Yeah. But it's interesting that some of the people who have come close to practicing this, like a Gandhi and like a Martin Luther mm-hmm. King Jr., are people who live on in our memories, who we all become proud of. All human beings want to embrace them.
Right,
say,
right.
I like them. They reinvigorate my faith and my hope in humanity.
Right.
But none of us want
but
to
But I have
be
no intentions
it.
Of it. Yeah. But it's the same thing with Jesus, you know. Yeah. That was so wonderful what he did. Oh, hallelujah. I have no intentions of following that. Mm. You know, it's... Yeah. I find in my context in America that nothing clears the room like questioning the righteousness of our military or the rightness of a follower of Jesus participating in. Mm. More people have left my church for that than anything else. It's just we have this strong, not only is it acceptable, but most Christians believe it's noble. And even godly, even Christ-like, and that just shows the depth of the indoctrination.
Wow.
But that's the call of the gospel. I mean,
at
its most radical, beautiful center, it is the call to love like Calvary, even in the face of persecution, even your enemies.
That's beautiful. Let's talk about Revelation. At the end of the Bible, Jesus comes back again, and he's so violent.
He's a butt-whipping guy.
Yeah, he is. He's got a sword,
yeah.
and he's wielding it out of his mouth, maybe, but still, that's got to be deadly. And so if Jesus is coming back and he's going to be really violent again, just like he was, by the way, you said he was peaceful, but he fashioned a whip in the temple, and he got really violent in the temple, didn't he? And we're supposed to be like him. And then he's going to come back in the Revelation and be even more violent.
He's going to wade in the blood.
Yes,
in Revelation
that's right.
19.
How do you deal with the violence of Jesus himself?
Well, okay, the temple thing, you know, people have this idea that Jesus sort of walked in the temple, had sort of a temper tantrum, got a whip and started whipping some people.
Mm.
Most scholars, in fact, all the reputable scholars I know, agree that that isn't what happened.
Mm.
This was an intentional act. I mean, one of the things that a Messiah was supposed to do was to based on a prophecy in Zechariah, was to come to the temple and clean it. And so Jesus is stepping into a Messiah role. This was a premeditated thing. He was also provoking the authorities. He came to Jerusalem to get arrested and crucified, and this is a really good way of doing it. And so he has his head-on clash in the temple. It does say that he turned over tables and made a whip. It never says that he harmed an animal or a human being. A whip, it was simply the best way to control a large group of animals. If you want to herd animals anywhere, you crack a whip. They respond to that.
Yeah.
He didn't use it on anybody. In fact, if he had used it on anybody, he would have been arrested right there on the spot. And that would have screwed up the whole timing of things.
Yeah.
So there's no indication that he actually was violent. He was aggressive, but love is often aggressive. He never used that whip on people or animals.
Okay.
Now, the Revelation is a different thing. It's much more complex, but the short answer I would want to put out there is this. It's true that Revelation has incredibly violent imagery, but if you look into this, what you'll find is that John takes very typical apocalyptic imagery. You know, the book of Revelation is an apocalyptic book, and so that was a common genre or type of literature in the ancient world from about the 2nd century BC to the 2nd century AD. And so what's really, really fascinating with John is the way that he takes the standard apocalyptic imagery, and yet he subtly subverts the whole thing. It is just brilliant. For example, a standard apocalyptic imagery is a lion eating crushing people. So you find Jesus referred to as the lion. But then there's this bait and switch early in the book where it's the lion becomes a lamb.
Yeah, they do a double take.
Yeah.
And, hey.
Well, you can't be both.
Yeah.
But it's a lion who's also a lamb. Yes. And yeah, Jesus wields a sword. But look at it carefully. Mm. The sword comes out of his mouth and it's the word of truth.
Mm.
And God's followers, they overcome. Triumphalism, that's standard apocalyptic stuff.
Yeah.
But how do we overcome? We overcome by the word of our testimony and the blood of the lamb.
Mm.
Which leads to Revelation 19, if you look at that. It's gory imagery.
Yeah.
The king is soaked in blood.
Yeah.
You know, and that was kind of the way the apocalyptic imagery talked. But if you notice, in Revelation 19, this returning warrior, he's soaked in blood before the battle even starts.
Wow.
It's because he's soaked in his own blood.
Wow.
You see, so there's just this, it is violent, but it's clear that it's not a literal physical violence. The whole book of Revelation, being an apocalyptic book, is symbolic, and it's violent love.
Yeah.
Now, if you're used to reading it literally, you're going to have to do a bunch of retakes on that.
Mm.
But it's amazing the way he subverts it. So I don't think that Jesus is going to come back whacking off people's heads. There will be violence, I think, as there is now. Mm. But as I'm arguing in this book, Jesus versus Jehovah, I argue that all the violence, God takes responsibility for it, even using I language with regard to it.
Mm-hmm.
But all of it is a result of God letting evil have its own way. And and I call it God's divine jujitsu method, where in jujitsu, you take the force of an aggressor and turn it back on the aggressor. Yes. You never use that force against
them. Also the case in Aikido, so I'm told.
Ah, Aikido. There you go.
That's right. Well,
have you used that metaphor before?
I have with because of Steven Seagal, who popularized Aikido. He runs like a girl, but he seems pretty tough.
Aikido.
And Aikido, Japanese martial art, uses
the
same.
I think you find this throughout the Old Testament where, and even the New Testament, where how God punishes, it's the worst thing that can happen, but he turns us over.
Yes.
Romans 1.
He uses what's already at play within that sphere of human freedom, and he outmaneuvers it and uses it for his glory.
I love what Jeremiah says. I think it's in chapter 31. But at one point he goes, you want freedom? I'll give you freedom. Mm-hmm. But it's the freedom to die. It's the freedom to use the sword and die by the sword. Mm-hmm. No, it's the freedom to be in darkness. But if that's what you want, I'll give it to you.
Wow.
That's what Paul's getting at in Romans 1. He gives them over to a reprobate mind. That's what you want, that's what you get. In Hosea, there's one point where he says, Ephraim has gone to idols. I leave them alone. Mm-hmm. And it's the whole thing of God hiding. God says, if you're going to push me away, I'll be pushed away. But when we do that, that's when our own violence and our own sin implodes. And that's, I think, how God's wrath is expressed. He himself doesn't directly do it. He just says, if you want to push me away, with a grieving heart. I think there's always, I just read a quote the other day by Terence Friedheim. He says, behind this, the harsh words of God's wrath are the wailing of God and tears.
Hmm.
It's like Jesus riding into Jerusalem and he cries over Jerusalem.
Yes.
He's talking about judgment. Judgment's coming, but he reveals the heart of God as he weeps over this. It's never God's will. He always does it grievingly, but sometimes he's just got to let us go.
This is an amazing privilege to be able to pick your brain in the middle of a season of your life where you're hot in the middle of working some of these things through.
Oh, the privilege is mine.
I wish we had a few hours to do this. I've never looked forward to an unwritten book more in my entire life, Jesus versus Jehovah. That's awesome.
Yes, I sold it. All right.
yes, absolutely.
That's the point.
So, I think this is, as you have pointed out multiple times, this is kind of the missing jewel in the crown of the church.
This is
something that many Christians who are passionate to follow Jesus have just stumbled over,
right.
And they don't know what to do with it. And I feel that there's a number of non-Christians who are going to be listening to this podcast, and they're going to say, you know, maybe Jesus isn't as bad as I thought he was, or what the Bible teaches isn't that bad. I'll give him a second look. But maybe there are some Christians who have just not known what to do with their own religion per se, and they're going to take a second look at Jesus as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm excited about that.
He's a beautiful Savior.
Yeah,
you know, Gandhi is one who said, he goes, If a fraction of Christians actually lived the way that Jesus lived and taught us to live, the world would be converted almost overnight.
Yeah.
Called to do. If there's any other way, I'll do anything for you. Morning dress, if it ever make a mess.